Hello everyone, my name is Harry de Koning, and it's a great pleasure to talk about the Academic Center Screening and Prevention. This is our screenshot. What we want to be is to be the most internationally recognized leading center of prevention as Erasmus MC. We have enough interesting, important research community to do so. I will in this lecture talk about screening, and actually I'm going to talk especially about implementation of lung cancer screening, a really new innovative field. But first, what are we doing in our academic center? On the one hand, we are guiding public health and clinical policies on screening to see what is the favorable effects, unfavorable effects, costs, etc., etc. And mostly we do that with using computer simulation models. I will not go into that detail now, but that's really how we started off at the public health department. And then we actually inform the US Preventive Services Task Force, in this case about lung cancer screening. They decide what is the best policy to do in the US. If they give an A or B recommendation, it's now officially insured by healthcare insurance companies. And this is an example in which this is an x-axis with the number of screens you can have. The y-axis, it says lung cancer mortality reduction. And of course, if you do a couple of screens, you get less lung cancer mortality reduction. If you do a lot of early detection and screening, you can much more. But so at some point, you have to make a sort of arbitrary decision. But the point is, all scenarios on this efficient frontier are actually okay. And this is what they decided to do, based on a big collaboration with US people. Another major example is a prostate cancer screening trial of which that Erasmus at the Department of Urology led, a European trial, showed it works. Earlier detection by PSA test reduces the dying from the disease by earlier treatment. So that's a big randomized controlled trial. And what we did is with that modeling, try to estimate quality of life effects, pros and cons, harms and benefits. And the third example is lung cancer. And then I will go to the implementation of lung cancer screening that I want to talk about. But also again, lung cancer screening, I told you about the Preventive Services Task Force, but actually with the kind of data we get, we also make individual patient decisions. So actually what we now have is a kind of nomogram that says, if my nodule is that and that size, what is my chance that this nodule is lung cancer actually? And so at the individual level, if you get a CT scan, you can make a decision. It's probably that and that size or that and that volume, what you do. That is about trials, about modeling. We do also monitor and evaluate national and international programs. These are the three examples for the Netherlands. And in fact, we are also evaluating for European member states. We got a big Horizon 2020 project called Utopia towards improved cancer screening in all of Europe, it says. And actually what countries can do is get their own data about screening, about detections, about sizes, about how many people do come for screening. And then with a computer model that we have on the internet, people can actually come up with the estimate on harms and benefits. So that's the kind of things we're doing at the Public Health Department, what we're doing in the Academic Center, screening and prevention. I'm not talking so much about primary prevention now, but we'll go to screening. Some other ones are a big risk stratified breast cancer screening trial of 12 million euros, which is led by the French country, a liver screen led by a Spanish country, where again the issue is, can we not risk stratify on screening for liver disease? But one big element of the project is a trial. Does screening for a disease work? Does it work? And for that, you often really need a randomized controlled trial. And we did a couple of them, but what I want to show you is the lung cancer screening trial. The lung cancer screening trial, called the Nelson trial, is published last year in the New England Journal. So that is basically the first randomized controlled trial in Europe, actually in the Netherlands and Belgium, where we specifically ask the question, if people get a CT scan and we will refer some people with a nodule, they will be treated if it's lung cancer, does it work, yes or no? And here you see the major stage shift you get. On the right-hand side, this is the control arm. Most cancers are found in stage 4, 46%. That's palliative treatment. No cure at all. Unfortunately, most of these people die within 6 months or so. But in the screening arm, where we didn't know that it worked, so people gave their informed consent to be randomized to a control arm or a screening arm because we didn't know it worked. In the screening arm, now 60% is being detected in stage 1. Only 10% in that palliative treatment stage. So this is the major shift we made, and with that, we get an important effect by treatment. The major other aspect, there's one big American trial also. There's this Nelson trial and a big American trial. The major difference with the Nelson trial is that we only referred about 2% for further investigation. So we did scans, and only 2 out of 100 people were referred for further investigation. We thought it's a suspicious nodule. And in about half of them, we found lung cancer. In the American trial, of course, because healthcare works that way, they referred like 20% or so. And then they even still got about the same amount of lung cancers, but they referred 20%, 10 times more. So we were able, with a low referral rate, even get important results. So we now have, worldwide, two big randomized controlled trials that show it works. And now all governments basically have to decide. And these are the point estimates, lung cancer mortality rate ratio, it says. So males in Nelson, that is the Dutch-Belgium trial, 0.76. So in the screening arm, a 24% reduction in dying from the disease. Until now, never seen before, except for the US trial. It's such a devastating disease, we didn't have anything in hand, basically. 0.76, the American trial, 0.92. So important reduction, statistically significant, 8% reduction, but we even better. And that's not that's so good that we were better. It just says that with a low referral rate, we even can do a good job. In the females, we get even higher point estimates. So not 24%, but almost 60% reduction. In the American trial, not 8%, but 27% reduction. So in female, it works in males, it's important in this devastating disease, and in females it's even better. So, what would that mean if you have a certain criteria? It depends a little bit, and you have 1,000 women without screening at a certain risk, 256, those are those gray bullets, they die from the disease. If you screen them annually with a CT scan, you go to 169, and so you prevent those 87 women dying from the disease out of 1,000 women. At a certain risk they are, of course, mostly they are smokers, current smokers or ex-smokers, and I'll show you in a minute. So this is huge. And not only deaths prevented, normally if you have lung cancer you have about 200 days, unfortunately. Now, if you have a CT scan, you're prevented from dying from the disease, you get about 12 and a half years additionally. Those are your life years gained. Even considering that there is comorbidity because you were an ex-smoker or so, you really gain more than 10 years. And of course, there's now immunotherapy. People try to get good cure even for some people, but we're still talking about 100 additional days or so. This is the major difference you make. Okay, this is actually, to some extent, some of you might have known this, mostly of course not, but nevertheless, the issue is now we have to implement. We know it works, the harm-benefit ratio is quite appropriate, and now every government has to decide what to do next. And so what we are going to do, based on a Horizon 2020 project, we are going to do the 4 in the long run trial, which basically means we're going to implement in 6 European countries. And what we want to know is what is now the most optimal way. How to get people in, how to get them stop smoking if they're still smoking. And one additional trial element is that if your baseline scan is negative, so you're not suspicious, you don't have a suspicion nodule, could you not then have a biannual screening or even maybe a longer interval, but for now it's going to, you just get one additional scan after 2 years, and otherwise you get every year a scan. And that would of course make a major difference, but we don't know whether that's safe enough. Lung cancer is such rapidly developing disease that normally everyone says basically we should do annual screening. That's what the most trials showed. And what we think is actually that if your CT scan is negative, your first one, we could maybe do better. And here you see that. Basically, this is from the Nelson trial again. If you had a negative baseline scan, in the next 10 years, you only have a 3% chance, well only, but you have a 3% chance of lung cancer. If your first scan was positive, you have almost 50% chance of having lung cancer. And there is a sort of indeterminate baseline result, then you have about 9%. So it shows actually that probably the baseline scan is very good for risk stratification. But because we're talking about so many people getting scans, we want to be definitely sure. This is the difference in annual screens and risk-based. And if you just have the first numbers, otherwise we may have 142 million scans in Europe. If you can do a risk-based interval, you of course, it almost reduces by 50% or so. So also in cost, you may perhaps save 10 billion euros. But you want to know whether it's safe enough. And fortunately, here again, lots of numbers. I just skipped to these bold ones. No screening, 200 deaths. Annual screening, 68 less. If you have a risk-based interval, you will lose a little bit, probably, we think. Only 60 deaths instead of 68. But you have less referrals, less invasive procedures that do not appear to be lung cancer. So you reduce that. So the harm-benefit ratio is probably better. But again, if we want to have 40 million scans in Europe, we have to be sure. So that's what you're going to do, a big trial. Men and women age 60, 79, they get the information and they are being asked, are you okay in being randomized between an annual screening or biannual screening? We know it works, so we don't need to wait for mortality reduction or something. We know it works. We're just going to show or see whether the stage shift between the two arms is not that different, basically. And that we know already in a couple of years or so. But at the same time, it's really implementing lung cancer screening. How do you do that? There is simply a risk calculator out there. It's called the POCOM 2012, difficult name, but anyhow, you just plug in a number of information, age, level of education, is there COPD, is there a personal history of cancer, but especially, of course, smoking status. And then you get a sort of risk that says my probability of lung cancer in the next 6 years is 3.3%. And so above a certain cutoff, we say, please come in to the trial. This is, like we say in Dutch, hot from the press. Indeed, the Health Council of the Netherlands has to decide on such a trial. We have a Population Screening Act in the Netherlands and in Flanders, the only two countries in the world that have that. And it means if you're going to screen for cancer, if you're going to screen with radiation, or if you're going to screen for a disease for which there's no treatment, the Minister of Health has to decide. You cannot do that on your own. You cannot do as a GP or radiologist, start such a program. The Minister of Health has to say yes. And we are fortunate that on the 9th of June this year, a couple of days ago, or it depends when you're looking, of course, I realize, we got approval to start implementing. And that means people between 60 and 79 years of age with a risk of 2.6% or more in the next 6 years, or they smoked 35 pack years, they are still smoker, or they quit in the last 10 years. So probably half of the people are not smokers anymore. They really quit, but they're still at high risk. They can join the trial. So it is called four in the long run trial because it's about intervals, it's about invitations, it is innovative, and to integrate comorbidity reducing services. I'll skip most of that, but for instance, one thing is that smokers and ex-smokers also have probably risk for cardiovascular disease. So on the same CT scan, you can also look at the coronary artery calcium scoring, and if it's high, you should probably get additional investigations too. We'll do artificial intelligence. This is one example in which, in fact, these nodules, this is actually a reasonably large nodule, but just to show you the case, with artificial intelligence, we can probably do even better at some point in time. But it's still a bit in the research development. We're building up a whole system with central units, screening units, whole data management system, so that, in fact, different centers can join. And in the Netherlands, we're talking about 7,500 people that we hope to include. So I hope I gave you a bit of flavor to screening and prevention, and specifically to lung cancer screening in this case. Stepwise implementation of lung cancer screening is now. We think that we are talking about something like 22,000 lung cancer deaths prevented each year at some point in time, if we do that. That is about the same as all the breast cancer screening programs in Europe. And you would think, lung cancer maybe, who is at risk? Many, many people are at risk. And in fact, this is about the same amount of effect as breast cancer screening in Europe, which is really effective. This trial, this specific trial, is an implementation trial, and it's basically needed to show that risk stratified screening is not inferior to annual screens, and that will be crucial for citizens, crucial for sustainable programs for governments and healthcare in the future. And I think I just end with some of the partners here. You see, this is an example indeed where Erasmus is leading for many European countries, and I'm proud to be and do that. Thank you very much.